Good evening, and welcome to another of the regular, though movable, feasts that comprise the Libertarian Alliance. And our speaker tonight is David McDonough, and his topic is the myth of the working class.
Thank you very much indeed, Bob. Now, most people would say that there is a working class. I was going to read out some of V.P. Thompson's The Making of the English Working Class, the first page, which is page 9, oddly enough, which talks about classes and so on, how people classes and the making of the actual working class and why it's called the working class. But I've left it in my bag, so I won't bother. I got the book here, but I haven't got my notes here. It's in my bag, but I won't bother getting it out now. And besides, it's clumsy reading it out of the book, and I'm not a very good reader. So from reading it out, reading it out. So he's right. I mean, there are basically people talk about classes, the working classes. But of course, it's an ideological thing to say, talk about the working class. It's a Marxist thing. Now Marx had the idea. Again, I've got the Communist Manifesto here as well. I was going to show you these two books, but again, I've left them in my bag.
I won't bother.
The Communist Manifesto, of course, said that the whole of history is the history of class struggle. In the Communist Manifesto, Marx had the idea that the middle class will be pushed down into the working class. And so he had a look at these three classes, basically, through what was then called the three factors of production: land, labour and capital. So the land gave you the landed class, the landlords. The capitalists gave you the capitalist class. Now, that more or less the people who were rich, I suppose, in some way, or owned capital. And then you had the labouring class, the working class, the people who worked. Now, of course, these were these factors of production were exactly that. They were factors of any production. And they were nothing necessarily to do with the marketplace, the buying and selling. If you have old Truso on his island, as most of the economists talk about, Marx included, you get work and you get the three factors of production, or as some economists would call, and I think they would be right, the four factors of production, because there's a fourth factor of production here that Marx amalgamates with the capitalist class, the fourth factor of production, entrepreneurship. So Truso on his island would he'd be entrepreneuring on himself. He'd say, well, what do I want next week? What will I save and so on for next week? That'd be Truso being an entrepreneur with himself. He's either successful or he's not. Most likely he is, because he knows himself, and he might have changed a bit, but he's not likely to get it too wrong. When Friday comes along and he has to guess what Friday wants, that's a harder job. He might pick up what Friday wants and he might get it right. The point is, his chances of getting it wrong is greater. The entrepreneurship with Friday. But anyway, on his own, he guesses what he wants next week. And he most probably gets it right, so that's the entrepreneurship. There is the capital, of course, which, as Marx points out, although Truso has been stranded in society, he's brought past society with him. He's got the English language and so on. All this is skills that he's acquired and help him organise his life a bit better. So these are basically capital. The English language is capital that we've all got, I should imagine, after the age, when we've reached the age of about 10. We've got some of it anyway. And of course, some of us have more of it than others. And then we've got other things, skills, like we might be trained as a plumber and so on. That would be capital. All that would be capital. And then, of course, there is the machinery, which is obviously capital. And so people who own that would be capitalists. But basically, they function in the modern society, in the mass urban society. They mirror the capitalists really function as savers, and I was going to say in the market economy, the returns or the earnings of the entrepreneur is profit, of course, and the earnings of the capitalist, the saver, is interest, and then there's the labour, of course, who will earn a wage or a salary for his work. Truso will be able to work on the island, making the cave a bit better, or building a sort of home outside the cave. and that would be his labour. And then where is his land? But of course, he's got the island, of course. But he's also, in himself, got his native intelligence, his body and so on, which would be basically a gift of nature, which goes along with the capital. And that would be his land. And of course, normally the reward for land is rent. So these are just functions. Now, in each individual, in Crusoe, in each every other is a fictional character, of course, but in every living individual, your normal adult has certain aspects of these four factors of production. Now, do these have classes that conflict with each other? Now, Marx just had a look at three of them, and he thought they did have conflicting class interests, and he thought that basically, he would say, if you had to look at this fourth class that I've introduced, that the economists have introduced since Marx died in 1883, he would say they're part of the capitalist class. And he would also say the aristocrats were part of the capitalist class. See, but what he does actually say explicitly in his 1848 work, The Communist Manifesto, is that the middle classes, doctors and so on and so forth, university professors, perhaps even, you know, people who are professionals, are pushed down into the working class. And oddly enough, he calls the upper class the bourgeoisie. He always calls them, and he calls capitalism the bourgeois mode of production. Well, bourgeois is middle class. So presumably what he really thinks as well, though he doesn't say it, is the aristocrats just pushed down into the old middle class, or to the new upper class, which is largely made up of the remains of the middle class that weren't pushed down or something. But anyway, he thinks that these classes are at interest with each other. Now, the myth of the working class is just that these classes, first of all, each individual has got an aspect of them. So in that sense, they're not mutually exclusive classes anyway. But insofar as they are, insofar as you tend to do most of your work as savers, or most of your work as a landlord, or most of your work as a labourer of some sort, or description, office worker or something, you still have the four sections in things that you do, but basically you'll basically be a worker or something. But then will you have any class interests as opposed to the other people in other groups, you know, people who are mainly savers and so on? And I can't see any interest. Now, Marx wrote a lot of books, but his main book is Capital, which is a massive book. It's in four volumes, if you count Theories of Surplus Value. Theories of Surplus Value itself usually comes in three volumes, and they're three hefty volumes as well. So you basically get six books, usually. And they're all of them are way over. Volume two is a bit slimmer, and it's about 300 pages. That's the slimmest. Now, this is a hell of a lot of writing. It's all on basically what we'll be covering in a few moments. It's all really an elaboration of chapter one of Capital. The basic things, the analysis of commodities and so on, which I'll deal with in just a moment, just to have a look at whether we've got these classes or not. It's basically an analysis of that, and the three volumes is really the three volumes at the end, but making volume four, three books making up volume four. It's called Theories of Surplus Value. It's really a history of economic thought, talking about the economists before him, how they're really concerned with surplus value. The reality is they wasn't concerned with surplus value, but that's. It's just the fact. I mean, they were concerned with what they were concerned with, and it wasn't surplus value. And surplus value is Marx's idea. And basically, Karl Popper, in the notes he left for a book that was published as The World of Parmenides by a Popperite, actually calls Marx Marx's theory, the labour theory of value, he calls it a zero-sum theory, and he says it's not zero. In actual fact, it's a positive-sum theory, we'll see the positive-sum nature of it just now as I go. Because basically, what he says is is that he says everything sells at its price. Everything sells at its value, and the price is the rough indication of its value. But the only thing that allows for a positive sum relationship, a movement away from the zero sum, is in fact a wonderful thing that Marx discovered called labour power. Now, what is this labour power? Well, basically, it's the capacity to work. So Marx thinks that the way we get exploitation is that we hire, or the capitalists hire, workers, and the workers have got a capacity to work, and they pay them a certain wage, say £5, and they try to push them to get about £10 of work a week out of them, or work a week or a day. You know, there's certain, some say X, and they try to get 2X per day or 2X per week out of them. So this is now the second X would be surplus value, and it would be, of course, positive sum. You're getting more out than what you put in. You're putting in the labour, and you're getting the surplus value out. So it's a positive sum theory, but it's only positive sum in this aspect. So you only can get profit from employing workers. Now, there's hundreds of different objections that one might make to the labour theory of value, and these hundreds of different objections can be met quite well by the average Marxist. I've met them myself in conversations with people when I was a Marxist. It's the easiest thing to do, once you know the theory. You've got to master the theory first. And I suppose that's why there's so many volumes of Capital, because you're meeting all these various objections and giving a full explanation of this. But it contrasts starkly already with what I said earlier on about Crusoe and Dean. Because if you have a look at the actual market itself, say for example if we take Alfred Marshall's The Principles of Economics, published in 1890, his look at the market, he says people keep talking about this being a competitive system, but it's largely a cooperative system. But there is some competition in it. But then he says, when you have a look at competition, any competition in society, let's have a look at athletics, Marshall says, you'll find that in order to have a race, there's got to be a lot of cooperation as to when to start, when to finish, and so on and so forth. So the competition takes place in a sea of cooperation. And Marshall says this is what happens all the time with competition. It takes place in a sea of cooperation. So now this is, I think, roughly right. Marshall is roughly right here. If we have a look at Marx's, in all these books that I've mentioned, this big book, Capital, all the volumes, and the other books he wrote as well, which were many of them, he's only got one example of class struggle. And in the Making of the English Working Class, which I was going to show you, it's 900 plus pages. It's got no examples of class struggle, not even one in 900 plus pages. And it's because Thompson hasn't got it clear in his mind what the class struggle is. But Marx's class struggle is this: wage bargaining. Get more wages, then that means there's less for the firm, and if we get less wages, that means there's a bit more for the firm. So on a given job, if the workers have more wages, then that means the cost of the particular job is higher, and the profits will be less. So there's this zero sum thing, between trade-off between costs and profits. Now Marx overlooks the fact that the landlord could say exactly the same. If the rent is higher, then there's less profits. The saver could say the same thing. If the rate of interest is higher, then there's less profits. So this isn't particular to the working class, this is, and nor is it a class interest, because this is the problem with this. The actual conflict there, the wage bargaining, is a pocket of zero sum within a sea of cooperation, and the actual deal will not be made outside the neutral gain benefit. In other words, any point along the line of which they bargaining will remain a gain to both sides. In other words, it will still be a bargain to both sides. Now, if the firm pays too little, then the person will go and get a job. The worker will go and get a job elsewhere. And if the worker asks for too much, then he won't be able to be employed by that firm. You know, in other words, wherever they settle in this wage bargaining, it will still be a positive sum gain where both sides gain. Where there's a, as Wicksteed would say, where the, Philip Henry Wicksteed wrote the Common Sense of Political Economy, he would say there's a consumer surplus and a producer surplus. It's the same whenever you buy anything, when you have any bargaining in the shop. You might buy a Mars bar, I only buy the Mars bar because it's the Mars bar is worth more to me than the money is. I only pay for a taxi here, which I actually did for a few things in my life because I was so late. I paid through the nose for the taxi, just like I paid through the nose for my Guinness, as Pat pointed out, because it was still, even so, within the parameters of that, it was still worth more than the money. To me, the Guinness was worth more than the money, and the taxi ride was worth more than the money. But if he'd gone up high enough, of course, I just wouldn't have gone into taxi at all. If they'd said £100 for a pint of Guinness, I'd just walked there. They said, well, I won't have any Guinness, then I'll have something else. So this particular example of class struggle that Marx has got, it's the only example he's got in the four of those volumes of Capital. It is actually a counterexample. It's an example of mutual interests, of common interests. But there is a pocket of zero-sum bargaining. And that's true. There is this pocket of zero-sum bargaining. But that is not a class struggle. That is not a clash of economic interests. It's a common economic interest by definition. Just like when I pay the taxi, it's a common economic by definition when I buy the Guinness. It's a common, no matter how much I pay for the Guinness or taxi ride, or no matter how much of over the odds. I only pay over the odds for that, on that particular, because it's worth it to me. In other words, both sides are gaining, there is, as Wicksteed would call, a consumer surplus and a producer surplus. In other words, the person selling, the producers are getting a surplus, and the consumer is getting a surplus. So this is, the market is a positive sum game, and there's a harmony of economic interests on the market. The romantics don't like this, but it's an Enlightenment point. Yeah, they think this is naive, and the real thing is running through the streets with guns after and trying to cause a revolution. My own opinion is that revolution is about as realistic as your soul, which I think is not realistic at all. I don't think there's ever been a revolution. There never will be. The thing is a story on top of a stick. It's things that historians like to write about. The French riots wasn't a revolution in any way, shape or form. And the Russian, so-called Russian Revolution, wasn't a revolution in any way, shape or form. And there never has been anything like. And of course, the revolution was introduced into the language in 1688. And that was, of course, meaning exactly the same as reactionary. It was going back to 1685. It was, you come one half of the circle away from 1685, and William III was going to use them to bring it back to 1685, the status quo ante. So revolutionary, and in the pristine political sense of the word revolution, it meant exactly the same as reactionary, went back to the status quo ante. So, of course, since then, the romantics have had, instead of bringing it round in the revolution, they've had it as going off on a tangent. But anyway, now, a slight history of the working class. Now, Marx called Robert Owen a utopian socialist, meaning that there was nothing to his theories. And the main reason why he said this is because Owen was too enlightened. He had the idea that you could talk people into socialism, and you could win this battle of democracy, as it were. Without a battle, it would be a conference of democracy rather than a battle of democracy. But Marx preferred the romance of a battle of democracy, of a struggle, class struggle and so on, and conflict of interests. And he said that Owen overlooks the fact that there's no use talking to these people. They're not going to give away their wealth. You'll have to fight for it and so on. And he seemed to think it could be done peacefully through democracy and so on, especially in Holland and in England. But nevertheless, he did think that it was expropriation and that it would be unwelcome and so on, and that that was what he called scientific socialism. And as a, but see, the point is with the scientific socialism is that it it didn't really have a look at any of the practical details of socialism. Marx even used the economic calculation argument against these utopian socialists, saying they haven't got a clue of how they're going to manage without money. Well, how is the scientific socialist going to solve this big problem then of the economic calculation argument? Well, we don't write recipes for the cookshops of the future. It's going to sort itself out later on. We'll just have to wait and see. You know, that's a scientific answer. Now,
cookbooks are expressly for people to make future meals, but please.
Well, most people, common sense people, think that Owen was a scientific type chap. He actually went out and tried to start up a new harmony in America. And, you know, it lasted about 2 years, which was not too bad. But he tried to do it, and he eventually, you know, a few people came in. Oddly enough, that's where anarcho-liberalism was born, because a man called Joshua Warren, who was actually in the commune that Owen started up, thought, well, this is ridiculous, but what we should have is private property anarchy. And so he was the first private property that we know of. Judge Stuart Mill refers to him on Liberty. He was the first person who started up private property anarchy in reaction to Owen's New Harmony in the United States of America. Although he came back having failed there and lost a lot of money, lost all his fortune really, and he was a rich man before that. I'm going to talk about it next week, but this, which will go into a lot of how he became rich and so on. But here I'm just going to have a look at Owen's testing, if you like, of the communist or socialist idea. Of course, the word socialism was introduced by Robert Owen from the French into the English language. So socialism was, the first person to use socialism was Owen. He was influenced a lot by William Godwin, and you may have heard of William Godwin's daughter, Mary Shelley, who wrote Frankenstein. Now, Godwin himself wrote A Theory of Political Justice, which more or less had a look at all these communist and socialist ideas. They weren't called communist and socialist, but they were, he did call them anarchic ideas, anarchy. But they weren't called communism and socialist ideas in Godwin's hands. But Owen was very heavily influenced by these. And Owen believed in the working class. You know, the working class. I mean, Ingalls was influenced a hell of a lot by Owen. And in my copy of the Communist Manifesto, it's in my bag, it's got a preface, it's a Penguin book, it's got a preface by A.J.P. Taylor, who insists that Marx wrote the Communist Manifesto alone, and he just put Ingalls' name to it as an act of generosity to the author. Well, if you read the Catechism of a Revolutionary that Taylor refers to a number of times, which was written about 4 years earlier on, it wasn't such an act of generosity, because the Communist Manifesto almost just repeats that, except in more flashy form. And Marx does that. I mean, I think the Communist Manifesto is better written and more, it's got more going for it than the Catechism. But the Catechism of a Revolutionary is not too bad, and it's got the basic ideas. So really, you could, I mean, and that's not just the, that's just one example, but there's many examples where the initial framework was taken from Ingalls such extent that you could even call it Ingallsism rather than Marxism. But still, they're the basic idea, the main details, and the working out of it and the confidence behind it was from Marx. And that's why we call it Marxism, I guess. It's a bit like an Alfred Russel Wallace and the Darwin thing, you know, except I think that Darwin did have the idea before Alfred Russel Wallace. But still, so basically Marx in that book, so the history of a class struggle. Now, that's what he calls Owen a utopian socialist as well. Now, what Owen thought that there was a working class, and he actually had a look at the working class movement in the 1830s, and he saw the trade unions. Now, most people, even today, Thompson certainly, in the making of the English working class. Takes the trade unions as working class organisations, but in actual fact they're not. They're anti-working class organisations, because although the trade unions say they're against the management, who do they fight and who do they beat up and who do they call blacklegs and scabs? It's not the management, is it? You know, if you have a look at the much of the violence of the trade union movement, it's not against management, it's against the average worker. And so, and Owen saw this, I mean, he looked into it, and first of all, he was keen on backing the unions. And then he saw that it was actually an anti-working class movement, and he wanted to start up a grand national consolidated trades, yes, plural, trade union, which would be for all of the working class. And Lowe was very popular, and he built a massive following, more than 500,000 men, and they had, the masses is where the money is, which is where a lot of people overlook. They soon gathered quite a lot of money, and they built a big hall in Birmingham, great big meeting hall in Birmingham, on Broad Street, Birmingham, and this was still standing until recently. It was demolished in order to make room for the new concert hall there about 10 years ago. But it was called, after Owen, it was called Bingley Hall. But it was originally Owen's, the centre of, in the Midlands, the centre of Owen's, the Owenite movement. But anyway, he started running down trade unions, Owen did, after a time, not at first, but after a time. And even in Russia, you may notice that Russia, because all these wretched movements in the socialist movement, they all influence each other, these ideas. And you may have noticed that in Russia, the unions were pretty lame, and they were put down by the government, the Russian government. I think a factor in that was Owen's case against the trade unions, against Callaghan's speech, James Callaghan's speech in 1978, against the trade union, in the trade union conference, telling them that he wasn't going to stand for these strikes anymore. It was very much of an Owenite favour. And you know, in place of strike by Barbara Cartland, Barbara Castle. There's a mistake.
She had red hair.
There's a mistake. They both had red hair. And they're both political women. Barbara Castle. She had this Owenite idea as well in place of strife. You know, basically, Owen then became anti-trade union. But whether he became anti-trade union or not, the thing is, he did note, I think, the strict economic fact that trade unions are not particularly in favour of the working class. They're sectional, in economic interest groups, and of course they have free opponents, other unions, which are very often in the same trade as them. There's more than one railway union, for example, more than one plumbers union, other unions. The blacklegs and the scabs, of course, who they sometimes beat up, and of course the general consumer, who's mainly what most people would call working class, the masses of consumers are what we call working class. So they're anti-working class organisations on three fronts, and they're not really anti-management. Well, you could say they're not particularly anti-management at all. They are not pro-management either, but necessarily, although they might help certain firms organise workers and so on. But anyhow, they're not working class organisations, according to Owen, and I think Owen was probably right. Now, Marx attacked this, oddly enough, in a much-read pamphlet, perhaps the most-read pamphlet of Marx, called Value, Price and Profit, where he attempts to answer a man called Citizen Weston, on the trade union movement, and to say, and basically what he says there is true, that under certain circumstances, higher wages can come out of profit. Well, I've already said that that's the case. So can higher rents come out of profit. So can higher interest come out of profit. But that's not, you know, that's, you know, now, I talked earlier on about Marshall saying that competition was in a sea of cooperation. The one place where we do get a zero-sum game and competition is, of course, between the various capitalists, between the various firms. You do get competition there. So you get competition within what Marx would call the capitalist class. But then, if you have a look at the other classes, they're by and large cooperative workers, landlords, savers. They're basically cooperative. So there is, this class as a class, and this idea of this class entering into class struggle is largely a work of fiction. There is no working class in this Marxist sense, or even in the Owenite sense. And of course, this big movement that Owen started off looking for the working class interest gradually withered away because it didn't find any particular working class interest. So it was half a million, much more than half a million. But soon, within about 10 years, faded away completely. And Owen, in his old age, became a spiritualist. He's not because he'd been a materialist all his life. So basically, he found no working class interest. There is no working class interest, because there is no working class as an economic interest group. So that's my thesis, I suppose, explained.
Questions?
Can you expand on what you mean by there's no such thing as revolution? Clearly, it seems that the particular institutions and the dominating estate have been swept aside, if not murdered, and replaced by a different set of people and institutions ruling the state. Is that not a revolution, or would you mean it's generally... You say because it's simply just replacing the ones that have worked is not a revolution?
I wouldn't say it's a revolution in any way, shape or form. You see, I suppose I've been over-influenced by Marx in this. Marx had the idea of a revolution, of going from one mode of production to another mode of production. Now, as far as I can see, there aren't these various epochs or modes of production. Marx himself is... he doesn't want to say they're absolutely clear-cut, and he wouldn't want to say that in the French Revolution you had a movement from feudalism to capitalism. However, that's roughly... He says that's roughly how it is. But, you see, I think that... I don't think that there is these various epochs. I think that if something works economically, then it will work in any case. So you do get the steam train superseded by, say, the diesel train or what have you, for one reason or another. And things that come later are probably better. But it isn't that the old things no longer work, that they've fallen down or collapsed. They work, but they just work inferior to the new things. So I do think you got riots in 1789 in France, and you got a change of regime, the ancient regime. But I wouldn't want to call that a revolution, simply because certainly not a revolution in the Marxist sense, because simply you don't have these, you don't look back and see these economic epochs in the Marxist sense. I mean, there are epochs in natural history, but I don't think there are epochs in society. But of course Marx was one of many. Comte had epochs as well. Saint-Simon had epochs. Most of these founding, what we might call the founding fathers of sociology, had epochs. I think all of them were wrong. I don't think any of these, I mean, even Herbert Spencer had epochs. And I don't think these epochs had anything to them at all.
But it does seem as though things are working one way up until the revolution, and there is a definite discontinuity. The American Revolution was there to kick the British rulers out, and they were successful in that. Yes. And after that happened, things were significantly different afterwards than they were before.
Well, they were not in the mode of production, not in the way of producing things.
But in the course of the way America would have developed.
Well, yeah. Well, I don't know. There are certainly changes. But you have a change at every revolution, at every election. And this bit, the Labourites take over, or the Tories take over, or perhaps even the Liberal Democrats might take over. But you have a change, and things are done slightly differently, and so on. But I think what is true of political parties is they mainly agree. I think that there is a continuity between the USA and the British colony, which was the American colonies. There's a great deal of continuity, but you know, there's a change certainly. But I wouldn't want to say, you know, certainly nothing like what Marx calls. See, Marx means a big change, like really, he thinks the abolition of money. I don't think you're going to get anything like that in the future. I mean, you might get the abolition of coins, you know, and you get credit cards and so. But credit cards are money, you know, in the Marxist sense. You know, I don't think you're going to get the abolition of capitalism. Now, of course, it depends on what you mean by capitalism, but you're not going to get a complete. You're not going to get. I don't think you're going to get communism. Or anything like it. And I don't think you had that sort of change in the past. But you do have change. You do have people killed and new regimes. There are different regimes. But you have that in every election. And people aren't killed, but a new regime takes over. You know, there's changes all the time. Or, you know, the end of the line comes where, you know, someone finds a firm like that chap who found this latest supermarket thing to come up. Name of it now. It's begins with. Is it,
they come and go.
Morrison's, that's right. Yeah. Morrison built up, you know, William himself built up this great big supermarket. It looked, it came become number three supermarket. But then he got the sack, and another organisation took over Morrison's. So that was a big change, probably a big change in the layout of Morrison's and so on. So you do get these changes. With Waterstones, you had Waterstone himself. Changed all the bookshops that he took over and made them far more user friendly. Of course, now he's got retired, things have gone back to the status quo ante there. You know, things are, the average Waterstone is a bit like the shops beforehand was, the W.H. Smith's and things that.
Yeah, but you're saying, yeah, change happens all the time. Mm-hmm. One king dies, another king takes over, but nobody says that's a revolution particularly.
No.
What they mean by revolution is a significant and wide-ranging change, or you can notice an historical discontinuity. It's not the same as just these trivial changes that happen all the time.
Yep.
And in that sense, I think revolution is a word that does mean something, and it means something where people use it in the English language. It might not mean in the Marxist sense in that socialism achieved, because that's not possible. It's not possible to achieve socialism, so that's never going to happen. So you can certainly do a lot to hamper the working of the free market, that's possible.
Mm.
But what you can't do is have socialism. It's not possible.
But you, I mean, there's plenty of meaning out there.
Yeah.
Soul is a word I use to equate revolution with. Soul means a lot. It's meaning, plenty of meaningfulness. The spiritual side of life means, you know, those of these things mean something. But you know what was said in Hamlet? There's more things in the world than in your philosophy.
There are more things in heaven than earth, Horatio.
You can reverse that. There's more things in some of these philosophies than there are in heaven and earth. Now, I'd say, on the whole, that Hamlet is right. There generally is more things out there than we know about. You know, and the things out there in the actual world, you know, they're going to find in the next 1,000 years, say, are things that we can't hardly imagine now. You know, just like we know a hell of a lot more about vitamins and so on than they knew 500 years ago. And some of the things we know, they probably couldn't have even imagined 500 years ago. So I think there are more things out there than we know about. But there are also certainties, like Christianity, Islam, and Hinduism, where there's more things in the tree than there are out there. and socialism is one of them. Communism is one of them. There's more things in the actual tree than there is in the external world. Now, I'm not saying the tree itself is very, very elaborate. Very often it isn't all that elaborate. And the world is definitely more elaborate than any of these trees. I think Hamlet point is right on that. But I would want to reverse Hamlet with many of these people who talk about things being out there. And especially when they talk about meaning. However, I mean, three bears is full of meaning, but it's not full of, there's not much truth in it. So I think revolution is like that. I think I used to think it was a wonderful word, full of meaning. And because I'm now, I mean, the ex-Marxist is a bit like an ex-smoker, you know. The ex-smoker doesn't like smokers.
So what
ex-Marxist doesn't like any of the old Marxist terms.
So what word would you use to describe what happened?
You can't, oh, called space riots?
You said riots, that's not good enough. I don't think
that's
remotely adequate to the situation.
Well, the famous quotation was, "It's a revolt. No, sir, it is a revolution." But he's saying, is it a revolution? No, it's not a bloody revolt.
It's a revolt, yeah. Yeah, I think Bonaparte made more changes than... now, you might... a Marxist would argue that Bonaparte's part of the French Revolution and so on. Well, I don't think that's true.
Well, he hijacked it.
Pardon?
He hijacked it.
Oh, yeah, I think the sort of changes he introduced... he did introduce a lot of changes.
All those bloody cheeses, all those weights and measures.
I didn't steal the French crown, I saw it lying in the gutter and picked it up.
Yeah, he reintroduced Catholicism and so on.
Was that him?
That was Napoleon said that. He also reintroduced slavery into the French overseas colonies.
And he reintroduced Catholicism.
Well, only a coloured folk, I just...
Hopefully, yeah.
At last.
Yes, just like I say, just on that American thing we were talking about, you were right and Paul was wrong, I think. I mean, in a nutshell, the American Revolution was over tax, wasn't it? And now the Americans are paying 10 times more tax than they were ever paying under the British. But anyway, that's a separate thing. Rather like the group, the Yellow Vests, who are rioting now regularly in France. They're rioting over tax more than anything. But anyway, let's come back to what you were talking about. I think it would have been a bit disingenuous, really. I mean, we talk about the working class. I mean, people who have to work for a living. A lot of people don't have to work for a living. And you never really mentioned that. You mentioned landlords who also work as landlords. I mean, yes, they're perceptive workers, landlords. There's a lot of landlords who don't work at all. They don't need to. Why should they? When you look at the financial system as well, because you didn't touch on that, where you have, for example, just a simple example, the printing of money, which is taken then from the factory that prints it, and who is it given to? Well, it's not given to people who work for their money, is it? And it's not given to me. It's not given to the workers. I mean, who is it given to? The money, I'm talking about the extra money, which is printed over the computers. I mean, these machines can print as much as they want to. Who has it? Well, the bankers have it. Then they pass it to pension managers and the money managers and to do what they want with it. So you've got a lot of financial engineering for people that don't have to work. I mean, literally, what Nick Clegg called the alarm clock generation, the alarm clock generation, people who have to wake up and do a day's work and come home. I mean, there are people that, many people don't have to do that. I mean, they just, money's just given to them. They don't have to do anything for it. Just step back and look at what Marx was talking about. I mean, that does go on, doesn't it?
There are a lot of people.
I'm not making a moral thing about that. I'm just saying
I think Mr. Speaker's point.
There are a lot of mainly the people in Dole. But you see what takes all this money is that, I mean, we've got a wonderful thing here called the National Health Service, which takes half a lot of money. All these things are, it's very hard for the government not to inflate when it's got the monopoly of money. But it's true that people who are rich, probably don't have to work, but many of these very rich people do work. For example, people like Elvis Presley, who was very rich through working. Pardon? Elvis Presley was rich through working,
yes,
and he continued working.
Okay, yes.
And people, see, a lot of workers become very rich. You see, if you have a look at these categories that I mentioned earlier on, entrepreneurship, savers, capitalists, landlords, people who own the land, and workers, very many workers earn a hell of a lot more than the average entrepreneur or the average saver or the average landlord. And someone like Frank Sinatra will earn a hell of a lot more than the whole factory of people at Longbridge, even in Birmingham. All the workers at Longbridge are not as productive as someone like Sinatra. And this is simply because of what people particularly want. It's what people are willing to buy. Now there was a thing, I was going to cover this as part of Marx's little main apology for the labour theory of value, is a little clause he has called socially necessary labour time, because people talk about, well, what about demand? What about if we work on something and it's not wanted? Well, he says, if you work on something and it's not wanted, then it doesn't count as labour. The only labour that counts as labour is the socially necessary labour time. Now, this is a big problem with Marxism, because the labour theory of value sets out to give an objective account of supply and demand and an alternative account of supply and demand. But hidden in this little clause, socially necessary labour time, is the actual thing that Marx was trying to give an alternative to, namely supply and demand. Because what constitutes socially necessary labour time is supply and demand. And especially demand. So someone like Sinatra can be he's not like coal miner who's really expending a lot of energy but maybe earning a pittance. He's earning out of a lot just by singing, which he might like singing anyway, and this is owing to demand. It's owing to the fact that what he produces is actually wanted by a whole bunch of people. You might not like it, but a whole bunch of people do like it. And the same with Presley or the chap who has been in the news for being a sexual pervert, Michael Jackson. These people are successful because they're successful singers.
Allegedly.
Yeah, but they are successful singers, whether you like them or not.
I was wondering who you were going to pick out of all the recent sexual perverts. There's just been so many in the news recently.
Oh, I see.
I wondered which one you were going to land on.
It wasn't going to be
Philip Green, Harvey Weinstein, Bill Cosby. Which one you were going to choose?
No, it was a singer.
David.
On that bum note, we end the formal part of tonight's proceedings and proceed to have more of the informal. Thank you very much, David.
Thanks for coming along. I'm sorry I was late.